Here's a controversial topic for you. Alcohol, drugs, and spirituality. How do they work together? I grew up in a beach resort, which means that the alcohol and the drugs flowed like water. It was a party town, and so the party accoutrement was there. You know, you could get your there was a bar at every corner, and even halfway between the corners there was another bar. You know, people were doing drugs, and the people who stayed in my hometown had a lot of local drug problems. But from the time I was in my early 20s until up into my 30s, I was a drinker. I drank, and I drank a lot. I would go to the bars and I would sing a cappella and I would dance and I had that long, beautiful Fabio hair. Those were great times. They were very fun times. They were also some of the times that made me do some of the stupidest things I've ever done in my life. Stupid things, right? Drugs. I have never in my life done a single drug. I have never smoked marijuana. I've just never done it. I've never been attracted to it. I've never had the desire nor the need. It was just something I would watch people do it. I'm like, well, I don't feel the need to do it. I don't have the desire to do it. And it's illegal. So why would I do it? You know? So it never was something I wanted to do and never did do in my life. Still today, I've never done a drug. Never smoked pot. Never done any of that. I drank. When I started having my big spiritual experiences and experienced Jeshua touching my heart, I had the greatest high that anyone will ever have in their entire life. The greatest high that there was. Unconditional love. Feeling that high, I very quickly was like, wow, I want that again. In that life and in this life, I want that again. In that life, everything got devoted to the man who showed it to me. In this life, I didn't want to mess anything up, so I stopped drinking. I still don't drink. You know, there have been a couple times over the past several years where my third wife was a drinker, and we would occasionally have a drink, but it was just occasionally, and it was just one, right? When I look at my spiritual growth and my spiritual experiences, I'm so blessed in the fact that I've had a lot of big spiritual experiences. I mean, out of bodies, kundalini risings, angels talking to me, you know, and in ethereal form and in physical form. I've had, you know, my cousin Carlos came and visited me after his death. My friend Bill did the same, you know. I've had these very big experiences. And I attribute that to a couple things. Just being open. Okay. Oh, well, okay. Let's try that, right? But also believing in the fact that all things are possible, right? But when I look at the use of drugs or alcohol or psychedelics even, I'm like, I got to all of these amazing places and had all these incredible experiences, you know, that without a drug, without alcohol, I don't doubt my experiences at all, because there was nothing in between me and my experience that could be an altered state. There was nothing in between me and my experience that could solve anything. And I mean, could not solve anything, but that could be the cause. There's a story Jim Carrey once told about Richard Pryor, about how Richard had gone through all his stuff, and they were, you know, he had burned himself doing, you know, crack, and it was just like crazy stuff, you know. But he had gone down some really dark roads. And it was one late night, and Jim Carrey and Richard Pryor were in a parking lot, and they were smoking a joint. And Richard Pryor pointed at the joint and said to Jim Carrey, "Be careful of that." He says, that'll lead you to dark places. That'll lead you to dark places. And Jim Carrey said, "What do you mean?" He says, "I don't know if I was funny or the cocaine was funny." And it's an interesting statement. He has a doubt in his mind that he himself was funny because he was on drugs, because there was something there that was causing him to do things and say things. He doubted his own comedic genius. And it plagued him through his life. He didn't know whether he is actually funny. And it's such a sad statement, right? You don't know. I have someone I know, and I, you know, at one point we were friends, and we've gone different pathways now for various reasons. But the first time he smoked marijuana was the first time he had an anxiety attack, which plagued him the rest of his life. Now, altering the state of your mind, which is supposed to be so clear, so that you can experience, is a recipe for not experiencing things and to kick you off into a direction that can possibly make you regret ever doing them or regret the experience. When I look at the use of alcohol or drugs and everything, a lot of times, and I've done a video on this before about my theory of addiction, I think that everybody wants the feeling of love. Everyone wants to know and come to know God, love, in that form. And that, and you know, that is what I experience in my life. As I when I meditate, I experience that unconditional love. I experience that feeling, right? The people who go into their fears and their anxieties, you know, are looking for a feeling, because they're not feeling that unconditional love. They're not feeling that vibration that makes them go, "Ah, it feels so good." They're not feeling that. So they look for something to make them feel good. They look for, you know, marijuana, cocaine, alcohol, cigarettes, pizza. They look for something that makes them feel better. The guy who I was talking about earlier with the anxiety attacks, he became a sex addict. And, it damaged lives all around him. And when you don't take the time to recognize the love of God at the bottom of every one of your breaths, you know, whenever you exhale, you let go of that tension, God is right there, right? But drugs, alcohol, sex, pizza, whatever you're addicted to, you associate it with a feeling, and that feeling gives that substance the power to let you exhale. I'm an alcoholic. I have a drink. I go, "Oh, I need a drink. I need a drink. I need a drink." I feel tense and I can't breathe. And then, I allow myself to exhale. Cigarette. Before that, he's like, "I need a cigarette. I need a cigarette. I need a cigarette." Pizza. Oh, pizza. Oh, I really want a pizza. Oh, God, it feels so good. It tastes so good. Right? We allow ourselves to exhale. We allow ourselves to get back in. The feeling that we're looking for is not in the drug. It's not in the cigarette. It's not in the alcohol. It's not in those things. It's in the breath of God, which is at the bottom of every one of your breaths. at the bottom of every one of your breath, when you finally exhale and let go of everything, there's a feeling. And I'll tell you a big secret. If you would just take the time and take a breathing break, that's meditation. And the more you get in tune with that feeling, the more you get in tune with that feeling, the hairs will stand on your arm, the goosebumps will rise, you'll feel it tingling at the top of your head, your body will fill up with this buzz, this high, this thing that you're really looking for, the feeling that is better than any high or any drug you'll ever have, is right there at the bottom of your breath, and it's free. And you can still drive when you're on it. You know, it is like the best drug in the world. And it's actually what you're looking for. You don't feel good in your life, so you go find things to make you feel better. Well, you don't feel good in your life because your fears and anxieties. And fear cannot exist in perfect love, according to the Apostle John. Great writer, by the way. Fear cannot exist in perfect love. Think about that. The reason you feel stressed, the reason you feel anxious, you feel overworked and you feel like you need to, I can't relax, I need to relax. The relaxation is God. The drug is the thing that keeps you away from God. The alcohol is the thing that keeps you separate from God. It's because you've substituted the feeling of a substance for God. Now let me say this. People are going to disagree with me on this. That's okay. I make these videos sharing my personal beliefs. I make these videos sharing my personal beliefs. I don't ask you to believe it. And I respect you for whatever you create in your life. And I respect what you're creating, unless you're harmful. If you're harmful to others, I don't respect that. But if you put belief, as you love to have your drinks and your drugs and you're fine and you're not hurting anybody, I got no problem with you whatsoever. My only thing is, what are you really looking for? What would you really want to have? Do you want to have a high that's so great that you don't have to have those moments of anxiety and stress anymore? To have a high that's so great that when you see somebody in anxiety and stress, you go, oh, I recognize that. And the reason you recognize it is because it's the way you used to be. Oh, I recognize that. Because you used to be fearful. You used to be in anxiety. And you're not anymore, but you recognize it. That's a different place to be. That's a different mental state to be in. To be in a place where you don't need an external substance to touch a good feeling. To get high is to make myself feel great, right? Can you feel great in any other way? I can go to parties and I can hang out with everybody who's doing any drug you want and drinking or whatever. I got no problem being there. They offer it to me, I go, no, right? Oftentimes they'll try to push it on you. I'm like, why would I want it? You'll never be as high as I will be on that. You'll never be as high as I will be on that, because you put your faith in that. And I put my faith in unconditional love. And when I feel it is the best high in the world. Why do you think I meditate twice a day? That's my form of getting high. So anyway, you guys have a great day. And I will talk to you soon. See ya.